speak about this little topic that I thought was super cool or super interesting
to actually expound on, something I've been thinking about often, and an issue that is probably hard to talk about sensibly without people kind of, you know, placing their feet in a little idea, in a little identity politics camps or ideological camps. And I hopefully will try and navigate this in the most honest and respectful way possible without, you know, stepping on anyone's toes, making someone feel bad about themselves. That's not the intention here. So let's try and go through this carefully, right? So this young lady called Tiffany Calver, she's a very well-known DJ here in London. I don't actually know much about her apart from I remember her coming on my radar because she was the tour DJ for Drake, I think, during the More Life tour. It must have been during More Life because I'm pretty sure she... Yeah, it was definitely More Life. I think that might have been the first interview he'd done in a while with this young lady. She's had a, she has a radio show. I'm pretty sure it's a BBC or something along those kind of lines. Drake came over. She was essentially the, you know, his kind of go-to person in terms of plugging into the streets and understanding what everyone's kind of playing, because she played that sort of, like, you know, the stuff that everyone's playing now, the UK rap stuff, the Afrobeat stuff. She's very plugged into that community or that scene, plays that stuff, sort of stuff on the set really well. People tend to like her, I'm assuming. That's why I usually get those kind of jobs. So, you know, all in all, great thing. And of course, it gives Drake more kudos points because he's, you know, basically plucking out a girl that's actually on the scene, actually doing bits on the weekend, performing in Dawson, performing in Shoreditch, doing all this stuff and putting them on that stage, as opposed to just plucking out some random person in America and bringing them over. He's actually someone that's kind of home-based, homebred, so everyone wins in that regard. But of course, she's probably going through a lot of inner turmoil at the moment, I reckon, just in terms of what I've seen on Twitter, for this whole Twitter thread that's kind of I've seen, right? Let me see if I can get the start of it. Where does it come to? There's an actual start that I actually think is more interesting to start from that little... Actually, let's go with this reply first. So it looks like she's going through some stuff. I think maybe, you know, in general, usually these kind of roles, or you don't really... I don't think when you get... Even if you're a girl that's as plugged in as Tiffany Calver, I don't think you... Or Tiffany Calver, if they pronounce it. Yeah, Tiffany Calver. I don't think if you're Tiffany Calver and you're on a come up, I don't think you ever dream of someday being Drake's tour DJ. I don't know if people have... Maybe people are more ambitious than I am. No, I wouldn't say it's a point of ambition. My dreams when it comes to the stuff that I'm trying to actualize are in line with maybe overall goals, right? Or lifestyle things. For instance, like, you want to be your own boss. You want to be able to call the shots. You want to have your destiny, or, you know, you want to basically have your destiny in your own hands. You want to be able to not be fired. You want to maybe have the possibility to maybe collaborate with a certain... You want to be able to maybe get to a level of exposure where you have the possibility to collaborate another with a so-and-so brand. There are... I don't know. Maybe I see it more general. I don't see it so hyper-focused. Maybe that's the problem. I'm not too sure. But even if she didn't, or she did not, but I think sometimes with these bigger goals or these kind of hyper-specific goals, once you get them, it can sometimes be a shock to the system how much else comes with that dream. So if you're saying, I want to be Drake's DJ, you have to kind of... You'll never know what it means to be Drake's DJ once you're Drake's DJ, the pressures that come with it. So I'm assuming this is what she's kind of suffering from. And it seems as if the questions that people are raising about how she got the job, why she's there, maybe the other people that were quote-unquote more deserving, are questions that I think happen or will affect a lot of people in the scene, especially the bigger it gets, the more exposure it gets, because naturally, the bigger the scene will probably end up growing. And I'm just talking about, you know, the kind of urban quote-unquote scene, the party scene, the lifestyle scene, because it seems as if there's like a whole generation of really cool UK peeps at the moment who are doing absolute bits, from clothing brands to styling to... I saw someone on Twitter the other day had posted a video clip of someone opening like a black-owned health food... is it health food store? Health food store, or like a wellness store, something along those kind of lines. There's actually a girl that does a really cool... that has her own little wellness studio where they have like facelift... No, it's for... What, yeah, face refreshes and all that sort of, you know, makeovers, facials and all that sort of stuff. So it feels as if to me like the scene is growing bigger than the people who can fill the roles. So naturally with that, and because people are worried that, you know, conquered culture vultures will come in and take those places, people are just trying to slot in where they can as quick as possible, so that when big corporations come and want to slap some money behind projects, you have people there ready to take the mantle and kind of spearhead it forward. But obviously, in that whole shift and kind of, you know, rush to get in, there's going to be some people left by the wayside who are going to have legitimate gripes as to why they are not in those positions. Like, legitimate, not even like a hating thing. Like, they can have legitimate points of contrition as to, like, why does she have that genre and I don't, when I've been in the scene longer, I put in my work, blah 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 blah. But obviously, if you're familiar with the scene and you're familiar with any kind of niche thing or underground subculture, you'll know that there are so many of these kind of stories of people just getting quote unquote left behind. Sometimes it's because they weren't persistent enough, they didn't hang around long enough, they didn't network, they weren't nice to hang around with, they didn't do good work, they weren't on time. There's loads of things that happen. People just get left by the wayside. And other times too, it's just a factor of life that you are sometimes not the chosen one at that time. There are sometimes a group of which I've seen, there's always a group of, like, let's say 5 to 10 people who kind of represent everyone else at a high level, and then the rest of you guys kind of you fill in the bottom or the middle to the bottom bit. So if it's like a triangle, the top bit of the triangle is the 5 to 10, and then the majority of it, 80% of it, are the people that actually support and hold the scene together. But sometimes it can be weird because the people that are the 80% bit, they can sometimes think the 20% represents the scene, but it doesn't. Actually, the scene's represented by you. You're the 80 or the entirety of the 100, and you all play a role. The more work you do at the bottom, the more big work with brands at the top get. And hopefully, if the top people are nice people, they can reach back down and kind of pull a few people up as people kind of exchange and go through it. And this tweet kind of made me think about it because Tiffany Culver tweeted on November 20th, I love this job and I wouldn't want to do anything else, but I really hope we all grow up and evolve and realize that there really are women in music industry that aren't groupies. They aren't trying to F or they're equals. So it's boring seeing comments like this constantly. And again, I have sympathy for it because I think, because it's just difficult. I think that's something that people don't want to talk about in general, because it's probably not an issue or probably not a topic that's of interest nowadays in a kind of political or societal, you know, field at the moment. But I have always wondered, like, what it must be for somebody, especially if you're going to come up and you're not very good or you haven't got to where you need to get to, like, for a very attractive female, what it must be like to come up in the industry and just trying to hustle and make your way in, especially if you decided to get in it late. Imagine if you're like an agent. No, imagine if you're like someone front facing like a DJ. Imagine if you've only started DJing 2 years ago because, you know, it just bit you one day. You know, we all start at one point. I started 10 years ago. It doesn't mean I'm a better person because I've been in it longer. But, you know, you might have stumbled upon a video, you might have seen an interview with somebody, and, you know, wherever you get exposed to dance music, one way or the other, you get exposed to it and you want to be the person, you know, on the mic, you want to be a host, you want to be a DJ, wherever you get involved. I've always wondered what it must be like for a girl that's like, let's say 22 and you're quite attractive, just that's not your fault either, you know, you're blessed with good genes, and then you try and get into an industry, you know, which is normally centered or around the nightlife scene, which obviously invites some sketchy characters in general or attracts sketchy characters. How that must be, like, what that's like, especially nowadays, where, you know, complaining about the handicap you have of being attractive might be seen as a little bit, you know, self-absorbed. It might come across a bit bad, so you might want to kind of bury that. What are you doing if you're that girl? Are you purposely trying to dumb yourself down, but plain, not dress up too much, maybe not wear too much makeup, not wear too much revealing clothes? That is going to be insane, isn't it? So I guess with Tiffany, she's probably going through the same sort of thing, right? If you're a fairly good looking girl and you're suddenly been elevated to this platform, it's no surprise that people that have been left behind or at the bottom or are kind of like looking up are going to, you know, just go to the lowest common denominator to explain why you're there and why they're not. And sometimes it can be hating. It can be just pure hate, pure jealousy. But sometimes it can be just a legitimate, like, question, gripe. Why are you there when I've been here for 5 years and you're up there? And sometimes just the way the world works, isn't it? Some people just get spots because they just got the spot because it's their time. They are meant to, they're like the spearhead, the figurehead that's meant to kind of enact some kind of change. I've kind of always said that about Virgil. I've always kind of thought that is what Virgil's place is in this scene. I think the fact that he divides so much opinion amongst even his own friendship group, I'd imagine, because you don't see many of his friends wearing his clothing, especially if they don't buy, especially if it's not seeded. You don't really see them actively going out and kind of supporting what he does in that way. But I think he's very aware that he might not be the most talented, he might not be the most able, but he's going to be the example. He sets the tone for everyone else because he's insanely hardworking, so much so he had to take a medically advised break from the scene because he was working so hard, right? So he's going to be the standard bearer, the kind of the bar everyone has to meet and surpass if they want to kind of get into the industry, which is good, isn't it? Because he's not a smoocher. He's not like a networking guy that kind of got his job just from being like the nice guy in the party. He got his job because he worked hard and bust his balls. So regardless of what you think of the output, it's just the example that you need just to kind of, okay, cool, I've got to work harder. So maybe that's where Tiffany Culver comes in that regard, right? Because if she did make it in 2 years, and you're, you know, looking up at her, maybe it's more a reflection on you not working hard enough, not doing the necessary things that need to do to network. Because again, all those networking, smoochy events and industry stuff, as corny or as cheesy some people might think it is, it's very difficult to put your ego and pride to one side and kind of try and network and talk to people who you are not aware if they like you or not, or, you know, just generally be in a space. It's not the most comfortable thing. I don't think anyone is really made for it, and unless you're like an actual pop star or you're trying to become a musician or an artist, so you kind of have to put on a face and just do it anyway. But everyone else, you know, it's hard work to be in those industry events. I know most of my friends that are still doing it now, if you buy them enough drinks and ask them to be honest with you, they'll tell you they hate going to these influencer things, but it pays, isn't it? That's their job. They have to kind of do what you have to do. So with Tiffany, I kind of feel a bit bad for her in that regard. But also, there needs to be an acceptance and understanding that, you know, it's okay that you've maybe made it because you're a female. It's okay that you've maybe made it because you're a nice person. People like you. It's not a bad thing. That's probably a good indicator that we've got quite far with the whole diversity thing. Because now the question is kind of being raised to the women or the people who are marginalized prior, when it was kind of like the bros club in these kind of scenes. Now they're seeing the same issues rise up even in the bros circuit, right? Because if you're a girl and you're thinking, oh, it's only dudes that got these roles or got these gigs, imagine the dudes that didn't get the gigs, how they must feel now that, you know, the light has been turned away from, like, imagine if you're like a, you know, your average Joe white guy from Essex and stuff. Like, how do you feel if you're trying to get into a scene or you're trying to be like an urban DJ? What do you have to do? Right, you don't have brightly colored hair, dreads, you don't have, you know, crazy tattoos, just a standard dude who likes that kind of hip hop, you like UK rap. It's gonna be hard for you to kind of get your way in, isn't it, really, on the most part. So maybe some people argue against that, but I think that's true. And then this other girl kind of said a comment at the bottom, which again is something that a lot of people are not talking about, the idea that there are these women out there who don't mind exchanging sexual favors in order to you know, get far in their life. I've read the Motley Crue book, Dirt, and you've probably watched the documentary, you'll know that groupie culture back then was a lot different than the groupie culture we have now. Groupies had a lot of power. They had a lot of influence. They were sometimes the glue that held some bands together. They were the glue that sometimes held the scene together, introduced certain people to each other just because they were around. Maybe exchanging sexual favors, maybe just being flirtatious, maybe just being the, you know, the muse for the scene in general, but they served a very integral purpose. Now maybe the whole term of groupie is kind of looked down upon, but I don't think using any God-given gift or prowess is a bad thing. Maybe when you get lost in the sauce, it could be a bad thing, but I think the idea of judging somebody for doing that is, again, it just goes to show that I just think the people that don't actually get to where they need to get to don't necessarily know what the game is about, innit? And sometimes you have to kind of sit there and say to yourself, what are you willing to do to get where you want to get to? And if you're not willing to do that groupie stuff, then you have to also be comfortable enough to say to yourself, okay, if someone else does it, I'm not going to judge them because that's what they're willing to do. We all have different thresholds in terms of what makes us snap. And some people, you know, the idea of going to a show and sliding into people's DMs is not that big of a deal, but maybe to some people it might make your skin crawl, and it's okay. We can all kind of coexist in this planet doing the same thing. But I thought the entire thread was pretty interesting, actually. Let me actually get it up on here. She sort of touches on another thing that I thought was pretty interesting, and maybe it's just like kind of just in general, she just probably feels a bit of imposter syndrome, isn't it? Because the come up has been super quickly, and it's been a quick come up, isn't it, right? So let's read the entire thread. So this is the entire thread from Tiffany Carver on Twitter from November 20th. I'll post the links below so you can check it yourself. But she says the following. I love this job. Okay, I've read that before. I'm learning to be okay with the ignorance, and that's not okay. We shouldn't be accepting it. We shouldn't also feel like we have no to hide ourselves or prove ourselves far beyond what our talent proves already. We have to raise our kids better. I'm not too sure about that. I think if you're Tiffany Corbett, you have to accept that there are people that are going to say legitimately, you're only there because of X, Y, and Z. And you also have to accept that maybe that might be the case, but that's not your fault. It just isn't your fault. I think the whole introduction of females in the electronic music space, especially where I'm more interested in, where it comes to, like, you know, dance music and house techno and all that sort of stuff, I think it's a good thing. For a long period of time, I always just say to my friends, I love it. I love going to a warehouse party, and you can obviously tell the person behind the decks is definitely not a guy. You can just tell by what they're playing, And by the just the texture in the air, you can kind of feel that it's a girl. You go to the front of the booth, and then guess what? It is a girl. You're like, sick. It's good to see, because generally all these parties I go to are just full of the same looking kind of dudes. And especially if you go to techno raves or techno parties in places like E1, it's the same white guy in the black t-shirt, you know, kind of looking demure and looking like he's hating his life playing behind decks. But when you kind of open it up a bit, diversity wise, even again, play music, I think you have to be careful. Same with, you know, other areas. It's still a space that you need to be proficient at your job. You can't just have people there just to fill a quota, because you're going to empty out the dance floor if the person's not good, and it's not going to do anyone any favors. As long as they're of a good standard and they can hold their own in the nightclub, I think I'm all with the diversity thing, because it just makes it more interesting, makes it more refreshing. But the issue that they're probably all running into, especially the new girls that have been promoted up, I look at the likes of the Charlotte the Wits, the Amelia Lenz, even the Peggy Goose, they're now noticing that they are being sniped at the same way the Richie Hortons were, the same way the Lucianos were, the same way the Ricardo Villalobos were, the same way the, I don't know, many others, Henrik Schwartz, right? All these guys were being snapped at in the same way, Chris Liebling, because they were essentially, they kind of represented the same archetype, the same old kind of girl. And now if you're a girl, for instance, and you don't necessarily tick any of those boxes that I mentioned of those previous girls, you might not be that social media friendly and stuff, then what do you do? So I think sometimes if that person complains about Nastia or Nina Kravitz, they're in their right to, because legitimately, like, you know, it's looking like they're getting everything, like all the spoils are going to the person at the top, which is again something that happens in general anyway, right? I think any successful person you speak to, they always have that story where, you know, on the come up they say yes to everything, then when you get successful you have to start saying no. And what you realize is, well, when you get successful, the opportunities actually intensify. Like you get inundated with requests, so much so you don't have enough time in a day to even, you know, hear them out. You just have to kind of flat out just say, look, I've got no time. I've blocked out this time to do this. Like, you just got no time. And then you're thinking to yourself, wow, imagine all the people kind of scrapping, especially scrapping for kind of places or opportunities, thinking that there's nothing out there, when I'm getting inundated with these offers and I'm kind of palming off to friends and all that stuff. And it's just every day your inbox is full of chances, full of opportunities, full of collaborations, full of opportunities to make money. But for the people underneath, they're not really seeing that. So you continue here. The anxiety that comes from just trying to do any job is wild. And I know so many other women can relate. This is a bittersweet feeling, because we shouldn't have to find peace in knowing we all go through the same damn struggle. But that's part of it, isn't it? I think that's part of actually achieving something and getting to where you need to get to. That struggle is real. And I also think it's just, it's not a bad thing. I don't think you need to beat yourself up over it. I think you just need to understand that, look, you know, you got to where you got to. There might have been some luck. There might have been some good graces. Someone looking up above kind of, you know, guiding your path without you knowing. But you can't control that. What you only thing that you can control is getting better, and kind of, you know, engrossing yourself in the whatever pursuit you're doing at the moment, and just trying to put your best foot forward, you know. Because again, I really think, especially in this era now where everyone's kind of, you know, obsessed about execution and how to post things and what lighting to do and how many, you know, it's obsessed about the details. I think sometimes the other stuff, the personal stuff of just being a nice person, I think people in general, whenever I've heard people speak about this girl, people always say she's nice, she's great person, everyone likes her and stuff. And even you can even listen to the Drake interview, there's a lot of warmth in there, a lot of you know, a lot of love and warmth there. They show they're actual friends. I think it goes a long way. People actually like you and are giving you chances because you're nice, even if you're absolutely dead at your job. I think that's great. And again, it's a good thing to promote, right? Like, we were in the era at one time where it was always an image thing where people were trying to fake it till they make it. If somebody's up there and people generally like them being around and they want to give them opportunities that way, I don't think that's a bad thing whatsoever. I think that's actually something that should be celebrated. It continues on. I'm getting thicker skin, promise, but I saw one comment too many today, and I'm starting to realize that by playing things down, saying nothing, and quietly trying to prove myself more because of insecurities that my male peers will never have to think about is helping anybody. That's not true. I think your male peers did the same thing. I think it's natural, honestly. Like, there are times I've sometimes read interviews with DJs and stuff, people, especially people who have, like, you know, maybe been in the scene for 3 years, and suddenly, you know, they're playing, I don't know, this person's playing Houghton, they're at Coachella and stuff. You're like, what? You go listen to their mixes, you're like, I'm sorry, but I'm definitely better than this person, right? There are occasions I go out, especially when I went to, like, regular club nights, and you just go, okay, cool. No, or when you go to a big club night in Fold, whatever, you might, you know, be blown away and be like, oh my God, these people are just light years ahead of where I am now. It gets you inspired. You go home, you start mixing, you start digging for new tunes. You know, it really gets you inspired. But there are times when you go out and you're like, bloody hell, man, you just have wow, this person's getting paid a grand a night, 500 quid a night, probably minimum, to play music that they love in front of a captive audience, and not an empty bar somewhere in the middle of East London or in the middle of the South or in nowhere landing in a warehouse somewhere in Hackney Wick. They're actually playing in front of a great crowd that wants them to be there. They get a rider. They have an agent. You know, all this sort of, all this amazing stuff that you're working up in your head, and you think like, you know, honestly and critically that, yeah, like objectively, I'm better than this person. That those can happen, but you have to keep reminding yourself and checking yourself and saying that it's not that person's fault, and sometimes it's just that that's not your time, it's not your place. You just have to take that again as inspiration. There might be 3 years into the journey, but you don't know what happened before the 3 years. Everyone's got different stories, everyone's got a different narrative. But it's also a legitimate grievance to have. Well, it's not, obviously it's not going to serve you well to concentrate too much on how Tiffany Corver got there so quickly. It's not going to serve you any, you know, it's not going to do anything for your career. But to someone to sit down and maybe to make a comment and say, hey, I think it's unfair that you got that role is one thing. That's up to them. They can do that. But I think as the person, as the kind of star that's been left that comment, you probably have to just internalize it as just them kind of, you know, it's more of a reflection on the person commenting as opposed to you. It's more so the pain that they're kind of going through. Just kind of keep it moving. There's nothing you can do, really. You can't combat it in a real honest... If you're really honest with yourself, there's nothing you can really say that's going to knock back that argument of like, hey, I think it's unfair that you're where you are and I'm where I am when I've been in it longer. Do you know that kind of argument? And I get it. It can make you feel a bit shitty, but I don't think the person that's at the top has to overcompensate and work harder and kind of make it look like, oh, I'm always at work, I'm not doing stuff and not post. Because I imagine that would be something that would be really weird, isn't it? Playing your head. Imagine you're that girl, you're like a Tiffany, and you don't, and it feels that people think that you only got there because of X, Y, and Z. Maybe subconsciously it will make you hesitant to start posting pictures of yourself on holiday. Put yourself, of you enjoying yourself, buying yourself nice things, because people are automatically going to say, oh, wow, that's what, you know, sucking so-and-so, whatever, is going to get you. That'd be mad, isn't it? And you can't think of that. You just have to let people have their opinion, what they have to say, even if it's illegitimate, even if it's full of nonsense, even if it has some point or some credence to it, and just keep it moving, really. That's what it means to operate at that level anyway. You just have to kind of be able to kind of listen to those around you, close, especially family and friends who kind of have your best interest at heart, and the rest of it, just kind of leave it by and by. And if you stumble across something that does kind of pull out your heartstrings or does make you think, cool, think about it for a moment and just keep it moving.
What else can you do? And it's just the following here. A really big reason I took the role on that I have now is because I really hoped it would help to switch the narrative, inspire more women to do anything in this world, and know that gender, like many things, should never hold you back. Again, I don't think that holistic kind of, save your whole gender thing is going to help you there either. Those playing those games, I would say, you know, you shouldn't be ashamed. You shouldn't be shy to say that, you know, you're ambitious and you took that big job because you wanted it. It was a great opportunity. Cool. If it so happens to inspire some women, fair enough. But you have to also be aware that it's going to piss some girls off, isn't it? Because there's some girls legitimately who are going to think that you shouldn't have that job or you don't deserve it. That's fine. But all you can do with your platform is, you know, pull your hand back. Like, same with the Virgil stuff. How many personal hype you have to go through to see people calling Virgil a fraud? But all of his friends are around him, his collaborators, they love the guy because every opportunity he gets, he's able to put other people on. Whereas a stylist, a photographer, a set designer, whatever it may be, he's always putting people on. So everyone's kind of contributing to his glow up. And in general, that kind of habit from that person at the top is going to then filter down to the people at the bottom. It's very unlikely that if he plucks some assistant out from the depths of Instagram to help him out, that person's going to be really tight with the opportunities. They're also going to want to try and give back too, to kind of, you know, extend that lineage. And you can do the same thing too. You can't help how people interpret it. It is what it is. But this idea that you're somehow rallying the female gender or women in general to kind of, you know, pursue their dreams is a little bit of a misnomer. And I think nowadays too, to be completely honest, there's never been an easier time to make it as a woman, really, isn't it? Especially a woman of color, or, you know, a person from a minority group. It's probably the best time because everyone's looking for somebody, especially if you've got some level of talent, to appeal to that kind of audience, because that's the audience that they quote unquote want to capture or want to seem as if they represent. So I don't know. Again, I just think there needs to be more blinders, especially if she's at the top of that level. She just needs to just kind of focus on what she's doing and not care about the noise. And the last bit here before I finish, I was terrified before my first show because I knew all of the things that were going to come with the change. This was a big one. It's sad that the fear I had then is still constant fear I have today, but I'm okay with it. Taking the bullshit
if it means someone else doesn't have to one day. Everyone's gonna take bullshit. I don't think it's ever gonna end, especially in the social media world. I think it's just too easy. That's probably why the likes of Logan Paul and Jake Paul get so much hate on the internet. We all know how YouTube videos are made. We all know how to do jump cuts. And when you're seeing somebody, you know, winning on that level and being so reckless with it, it's only natural that if you're a YouTube creator that you'd also hate their guts, right? It makes complete sense. There's nothing wrong with that. But I think if you're Jake Paul and Logan Paul, you can't ever think about or focus on what those people are saying. You just have to kind of isolate yourself, incubate yourself around the people that are trying to make content to, trying to pursue their dreams, and just keep putting out content, especially if the audience likes it. Because again, like I say, the market always decides. If the market has kept this girl in a job at the BBC, if she's getting good listens and good plays, then the market is deciding that they like you. They're deciding with the times that they're pressing play on that online radio player, right? Especially nowadays in the era of podcasting, like, who the hell is listening to radio? I don't listen to radio. People are listening to radio and they're tuning into your show. They actually like you. Do you know what I mean? They proper think you're good. They proper think you're sick. And if people like Drake are, you know, wanting you to go on tour with him and be his tour DJ, he thinks you're sick too. And then people see you playing, like, oh, that girl's actually really good. And they want you to play and you get more bookings. So it's essentially the market's deciding your value. The moment the market doesn't think your value matches your talent or matches your platform, that's when the gigs will start to decrease and obviously things will start falling by the wayside. Hopefully not, but you know, that's how it goes. So to think somehow that's going to change, or never will change, and that's how it is. That's how it's always been. But I think, again, maybe it's just an imposter syndrome thing. Maybe again, it is kind of a self sabotage thing too, because she just mentioned in this tweet, I was terrified before my first show because I knew what were the good things. I knew the things, all the things that would we're going to come with the change. And that happens quite a lot in itself, sabotaging, where you kind of mess things up for yourself because you're uncomfortable with the idea of potentially reaching a really high level that will then require you to do things that you're probably not willing to do at that point in time, whether it's kind of focus completely on work and not go out, whether it's invest your money in little side hustle you're doing. Sometimes we all do as humans because you're so afraid of actually trying to reach your dreams, which is probably the main reason or the main crux of a lot of, especially actual legitimate haters. I'm not talking about people that actually have an opinion on your career and think it's unfair, but I think legitimate haters, that's probably where they come from. Their point of pain, I would assume, is that when they see someone like a Tiffany or someone that's actually doing their thing and going for their dreams, it just is a direct mirror reflection of what is kind of, it serves as a mirror for why they're not where they should be, essentially. And it makes them feel uncomfortable when someone's really ambitious and really confident and, you know, talks a big game, backs it up, delivers. It makes them uncomfortable because it shows that you can do it if you believe in yourself, and that in general, they're kind of holding themselves back. They're their own worst enemy. I kind of relate it a little bit back to, like, you know, my mum, you know, a conservative African woman who, anytime I mention I'm going to invest a bit of money in a party or put an event on or buy some equipment or whatever it may be for this tiny project that I'm doing, she's very, like, risk averse, very scared, because her whole entire life she's had to battle, scrimp and save to kind of feed, you know, and house three young boys, you know, growing up in London and trying to make sure no one dies and no one ends up in prison. So the idea of kind of taking a risk doesn't work in her head, because she's under the guise of, like, if I keep my head down, work hard, I'll get my passport, I'll vote Labour, I'll keep my council house, and I'll keep trucking on. So to get offended at my mum thinking that what I'm doing is a bad idea, or that I'm wasting my money, or that I'm being stupid, is doesn't make any sense, because I understand her point of view, I understand her point of pain that she's coming from. I think you have to kind of have the same sort of sympathy or empathy when it comes to people online leaving random comments. I'd say just kind of strip away the venom in it, probably don't see it as a direct insult or directly towards you, and maybe see it more as a reflection of where that person's coming from. I would say, anyway, I'm not too sure, maybe I don't really have the reason to it, but again, I think it's an interesting point to be at the moment now. Like, the girls coming through now, I know, are kind of going through the same thing some of the bigger dudes were going through when they first get into the scene, and they were winning and sweeping up everything. I'm pretty sure, even in the EDM world, I'm pretty sure there's a gazillion guys in the EDM world who are banging out tunes, uploading them out on SoundCloud and getting two listens, who are kind of annoyed that Martin Garrix keeps getting all the awards and getting flown around the world in private planes, isn't it? Like, it's just, they're probably annoyed too. It is what it is. You just have to kind of keep it moving and hope that in the end, you know, other people also get their chances. But I think for the ones that are sniping on the outside, you have to understand that everyone has their role to play. That's her role. She's meant to be the person at the BBC doing these kind of big commercial things. And maybe your place is to do something else. You have to create your own opportunities, isn't it? I think in that regard, you can't wait around or pointing.